prayer this morning is that those won't be just words that we sing on a screen or that we sing because we know that song well. But my hope and prayer is that that will be the truth of your life this morning, is that you will truly know God's grace and that we can celebrate God's grace together here this morning, truly trusting in Him as our Lord and Savior. And so, as we continue worshiping together this morning and thinking about those things, open up your Bibles, open up your phone, open up whatever you use to read God's Word, to Hebrews chapter 7. And we are going to look this morning at the fact that Christ is the one and only. He's the only one that we need in our lives. He's the only one that we truly need for salvation and hope in our lives. And as you turn into that passage of Scripture, the writer of Hebrews starts us off in a little bit different way. And I couldn't help but think, I don't know if you're like me or not, but do you ever go around, like when you're usually like at Walmart or a store or something like that, and you see somebody and you instantly relate them to somebody else? You're always kind of connecting them to somebody else, maybe from somebody in your past, maybe somebody that you once knew. You know it's not them. Okay, you know it's not that person you're thinking of, but I do that a lot. When I see somebody, I think, oh, he looks like so-and-so, or she looks like this person over here. And you start making some connections, and then if you look at them long enough, you say, well, no, they're not exactly alike. You'll see differences in their features or whatever it is about them. But I tend to do that a lot. When I see somebody, I'll just automatically relate them to somebody else. Well, to a degree, that's what the writer of Hebrews is doing here in our passage of Scripture this morning. He's talking about Christ, and Christ is the one and only. He's the only one that we need for salvation. But in order to help the people that are reading this letter that he's written to them, in order for them to understand and make a connection here, he compares them to somebody that they would have at least known a little bit about. Christ is compared here and in the upcoming chapters to a priest and king by the name of Melchizedek. All right, and so the writer of Hebrews here is making this connection in order to help them to get a mental picture of what's going on here, because the readers of that day, it doesn't make a whole lot of sense to us because, you know, Melchizedek, how many Melchizedeks do you know? How many Melchizedeks are there even in the Bible? There's only one that we know of in Scripture, and so it's not something that is well known, but the readers of the day when this letter was first written would have understood, and they would have known something about Melchizedek, and they would have made associations with him in comparison to their way of life. Because again, remember, the writer of Hebrews here is writing to primarily a Jewish congregation, Jewish people, and so they would have understood all the rituals from the Old Testament. They would have understood the temple practice. They would have understood having to come and bring physical sacrifices and offerings on a regular basis. They would have understood all the rituals and procedures that they would do on a daily and yearly basis. And so they would have had all these things in their mind, and so naturally they would have taken and they would have compared Jesus to certain people and certain events, and most likely certain priests that they knew growing up, because they had priests that on a regular basis would be offering up sacrifices for them. And so when we come to this passage of Scripture, the writer of Hebrews is saying, I want you to get a different picture in mind. I want you to think about Jesus differently than maybe you would normally think about him. Just like I'll go into Walmart, or I'll go somewhere and I'll see somebody and I'll identify them with somebody else. Well, that may not be an accurate picture of who they are. Obviously, that's not who they are, and I have to get to know them. Would have to get to know them personally to find out who they really are. But I can make assumptions because of my conditioning and what I'm thinking of. And so here, the writer of Hebrews is trying to recondition their thinking to a right understanding of who Jesus Christ is, and that's important for us here today, to make sure we have a right understanding of who Jesus Christ is. A right understanding of why we need to trust in Him as our Lord and Savior. Why we need to put our faith in Him, in Him alone. Why we can sing these songs that we've been singing of praise to Him and celebration of who He is, so that we can truly worship Him in a right and a proper way. So let's look at our passage of Scripture this morning. I want to look at verses 1 through 10 to begin with, and a few comments, but we're really going to focus on the later verses a little bit more. But the writer of Hebrews tells us this in verse 1 of chapter 7. This Melchizedek was king of Salem and priest of God Most High. He met Abraham, returning from the defeat of the kings, and blessed him And Abraham gave him a tenth of everything. First, his name means King of Righteousness. Then also, King of Salem means King of Peace. Without father or mother, without genealogy, without beginning of days or end of life, like the Son of God, he remains a priest forever. Just think how great he was. Even the patriarch Abraham gave him a tenth of the plunder. Now the law requires the descendants of Levi who become priests to collect a tenth of the from the people, that is, their brothers, even though their brothers are descended from Abraham. This man, however, did not trace his descent from Levi, yet he collected a tenth from Abraham and blessed him who had the promise. And without doubt, the lesser person is blessed by the greater. In the one case, the tenth is collected by men who die, but in the other case, by him who is declared to be living. One might even say that Levi, who collects the tenth, paid the tenth through Abraham, because when Melchizedek made Abraham, Levi was still in the body of his ancestor. So again, I know a mouthful, we're not going to delve into all the history of everything that's going on here, but basically, the writer of Hebrews is saying, this Melchizedek, you need to kind of change your mindset a little bit about how you might view Jesus, okay? Jesus is not like the priest that you would understand and you would know from your childhood and from your upbringing. He's more like Melchizedek. And who is this Melchizedek? Well, we don't know a lot about him. There's only two references besides what we have here in Hebrews in the Old Testament to him. One comes from Genesis chapter 14, and then there's just one verse in Psalm 110. But what we do know about Melchizedek is that he was both a king and a priest. All right, and this was well before Moses was on the scene and his brother Levi was on the scene, and then all the Levites, Aaron, and all the Levites that would follow along behind Moses and Aaron from that lineage there. Long before any of that happened, here you have Melchizedek, and you have Abraham, who comes and offers a sacrifice to Melchizedek. And so what we know about Melchizedek and what we need to understand about him is that he served in a title that would Abraham being the father, the patriarch of all people, here you have him worshiping and bowing down to somebody outside of his lineage. And so Melchizedek serves as one who actually becomes superior to Moses or to Abraham, because Abraham is actually offering a tenth to him, just like the Levitical priest would. And so we know from him that he is a priest of God, okay? Called by God, special, we don't know where he came from. We don't have any genealogy of where he ended, and sons and daughters and family lineage. We just have Melchizedek, who served as one that Abraham came and bowed down to and blessed him, and who Abraham actually gave offerings to. And so he's used here as an example of who Christ is and how we need to understand Christ. And so now you say, well, what's all this have to do with us here today? And what is this? How does this apply to us? Well, let's go on with our text here and we'll see how this applies and what we need to understand about Jesus from the rest of our text. Look at verse 11. It's here the writer of Hebrews begins to make his point in how it applies to even us. If perfection could have been attained through the Levitical priesthood, for on the basis of it the law was given to the people, why was there still need for another priest to come? One in the order of Melchizedek, not in the order of Aaron. That's the same question we have to ask ourselves, is why do we need somebody outside of ourselves? Because that's basically what it was. The Jewish people said, we've got our priests, we've got our leaders, we've got our high priest, and we've got all these that are given assignments and given tasks to do. Why do we need somebody beyond ourselves in order to find life and in order to find righteousness and in order to ultimately find eternal life? Well, that's the question that's being asked here and ultimately going to be answered, because perfection could not be obtained through anything we can do, but perfection must be obtained outside of ourselves. So look at verse 12. For when there is a change of the priesthood, there must also be a change of the law. He of whom these things are said belonged to a different tribe, and no one from that tribe has ever served at the altar. For it is clear that our Lord descended from Judah, and in regard to that tribe, Moses said nothing about priests. And what we have said is even more clear if another priest like Melchizedek appears, one who has become a priest, not on the basis of a regulation as to his ancestry, but on the basis of the power of an indestructible life. For it is declared, you are a priest forever in the order of Melchizedek. The former regulation is set aside because it is weak and useless, for the law made nothing perfect, and a better hope is introduced by which we draw near to God. And it was not without an oath. Others became priests without an oath, but he became a priest with an oath when God said to him, the Lord has sworn and will not change his mind. You are a priest forever. Because of this oath, Jesus has become the guarantee of a better covenant. Now there have been many of those priests since death prevented them from continuing in office. But because Jesus lives forever, he has a permanent priesthood. Therefore, he is able to save completely those who come to God through him, because he always lives to intercede for them. Such a high priest meets our need, one who is holy, blameless, pure, set apart from sinners, exalted above the heavens. Unlike the other high priests, he does not need to offer sacrifices day after day, first for his own sins and then for the sins of the people. He sacrificed for their sins once for all when he offered himself. For the law appoints as high priests men who are weak, but the oath which came after the law appointed the Son, who has been made perfect forever. The point of what we are saying is this. We do have such a high priest who sat down at the right hand of the throne of the majesty in heaven and who serves in the sanctuary, the true tabernacle set up by the Lord, not by man. So this morning, what I want us to gather here this morning, what I want us to either be reminded of, or maybe for some of us in here today, to know for the very first time who this Jesus Christ is that we serve. Okay, well, when we think about Jesus Christ, he's not just an extension. He's just not kind of a new and improved model of what they once had. Okay, Jesus is not just somebody who came along and did it a little bit better. When we talk about Jesus Christ and what we need to understand about Jesus Christ in our own lives is that he is the final and complete one. Okay, there is no need for anybody or anything else after Jesus Christ. Okay, he is the one and only perfect priest. And so that's why the writer of Hebrews here refers to him as Melchizedek, because the readers would have said, well, yeah, we've heard about this Melchizedek, but we don't really know much about him.
Singing that song.
Where he came from, there's four. What happened afterwards, but here we have this one priest who Abraham came and offered a sacrifice to him and was bowing down and worshiping him. And so he says, that's what you have to think about with Jesus. He's not just an extension of what you already have, but he's something new. He is something better. He is complete and final in all that he does. So what's the basis for this claim? Because this is the same Jesus we worship today. Right? This letter was written basically 2,000 years ago. And in those 2,000 years, think about all the things that have changed over the last 2,000 years. Think about all the things that have changed in the last 20 years. And yet, from 2,000 years ago to today, there's nothing better, there will nothing be ever be better than what we have in Jesus Christ. And we come here week in and week out to worship our Lord and Savior, the one and only, who can give us hope and can give us life and give us peace and give us direction for living this life and assurance for eternal life. So what's the basis for that? Why do we come here and lift up the name of Jesus Christ. Why do we sing songs of praise to Him each and every day? Why do we try to shape our lives each and every day that we live, not just on Sundays, I hope, and not just on Wednesdays, but each and every day? Why do we try to shape our life into something that is pleasing and honorable to Him? Why do we give ourselves to Him and devote ourselves to Him? Because He's not like one of these priests that the people 2,000 years ago would have known. Well, you know, yeah, we remember his priest. We remember his dad who was a priest. We remember his grandfather that was a priest. And we know his son who will one day become a priest. And there was this continuous cycle of different ones that would lead and guide, and they would give their offerings to. Here, the writer of Hebrews says, is the one and only, the final and complete. So what does he base his life on? Why do we trust in Jesus Christ? Why should you trust in Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior today? Well, let's look at what the text says, and I'm just going to pull out a couple verses for us to focus on here this morning. But in verse 16, I want you to see, and throughout really these verses, beyond that even, he talks about the fact that Jesus Christ is the indestructible one. He is the one that will never, ever be destroyed. You're going to get a recurring theme here through this book in Hebrews about anchoring ourselves to Jesus Christ, okay? Having a good anchor hold. He already talked about that in chapter 6 toward the end. He'll talk about it a little bit later on in the book of Hebrews. But he's talking about the fact that you need to anchor your life to somebody, to something. And here he's saying you better anchor yourself to Jesus Christ. If you're going to anchor yourself to something, would you rather anchor yourself to a rock or to a sandbar? You don't anchor yourself to something that's going to shift and change. And if you do anchor yourself there, and so many people do that in this life, they anchor themselves to something that's going to change over time, that's not going to be complete, that's not going to last. It's going to be temporary. It may look good for a little while, and it may hold for a few days or a few weeks or even for a few years, but eventually it's not going to stay. Just read an article the other day. I think it's somewhere outside of on the North Carolina coast or South Carolina coast, but this new island has popped up. And I didn't realize that, but with the shifting sands, I guess with the way the tidal currents go and the way the storms come, the waves work, occasionally new islands will just actually pop up. And this one's big enough that you can go over and you can, you know, get out of it a little bit. Now, they're not recommending you do that because it's not stable. There's, of course, some people are going to go out there and they're going to explore it. They're going to look at it. But you know what? It wasn't there a few years ago. And a few years from now, it may be gone again. It's not going to last. And if you're anchoring yourself, if I went out there today and built a house, I better sell it pretty quick or I'm not going to get anything out of it. Because as soon as that island fades away, it's gone. There's no foundation. There's nothing to anchor it. You anchor to there. So the writer of Hebrews tells us today that Jesus Christ is the indestructible one. He's the one and only who ultimately overcame death. He is the one that is the first fruit of the resurrection because he died. What we focus on Good Friday, the Friday before Easter, is the fact that he died. He was completely dead. He went into that grave. He was in that tomb. But then on the third day, on that Sunday morning, he rose again. And that resurrection is where we place our hope. Because he overcame death. I saw recently the movie. I don't know how many of y'all have seen it, but one of the movies that I will recommend that you go and watch is The Case for Christ. It's the story, Lee Strobel's story. Now, of course, if you read the book, it's obviously a little bit different. You know, anytime you have to condense several years of something down into about an hour and a half, you know, you're always going to have to kind of cut corners a little bit, change a few things, but it was a good movie. And this is a true story about Lee Strobel, that when his wife came to faith in Jesus Christ, his faith was challenged. He was an atheist. His wife was an agnostic. She became a believer, and that really disrupted their marriage. And he wanted to go out and disprove who Jesus Christ was. He wanted to set his wife straight and get her back on the right track of not believing in this Jesus, because who would want to believe in that fairy tale of somebody who died and rose again? And so as he was thinking through, how do I disprove this Jesus, the crux of who Jesus Christ is, and Paul himself tells us this in 1 Corinthians, is that it all revolves around the resurrection. If the resurrection is not true, if Jesus did not rise from the dead, then our whole faith is nothing. Our whole faith rests on absolutely nothing. It's one of those sandbars that will shift and change over time. If there's no resurrection, Paul says it there in 1 Corinthians 15, if Christ didn't rise from the dead, then we are to be pitied most of all, because what we do here today, what we do with our lives, means nothing. But if the resurrection is real, then it means everything. Amen. And so Lee Strobel went out to disprove the resurrection. He went out to disprove the credibility of God's word, that you really couldn't believe what was written there in the Gospels and what was prophesied earlier. You really couldn't believe that Jesus Christ did come back from the dead, or maybe he really wasn't dead, and all those kinds of things. And if you've read the book, or if you've gone to see the movie, you know where he is, and Lee Strobel is still alive today and still faithfully serving today. But he went out to disprove who Jesus Christ was, that he was just a mere man. But through his research, and if you know anything about him, he was a journalist who did, losing track of thought, what type of journalist he was, but where he would go out and prove stories, true or not. Anyway, that was his life. And in his research, instead of disproving who Jesus Christ was, he actually came to understand that Jesus Christ truly was who he is. That you can believe what God's word says. You can believe the scriptural evidence that we have. And you can believe the accounts of who Jesus Christ is. And instead of coming to a point where he set his wife straight and disproved who Jesus was, he understood that what we have here in Hebrews, what we have here in the Gospels, what we have here in all of God's word, is that Jesus Christ, we base our truth, we base our understanding on the fact that he does have an indestructible life, because he did die, but he also rose again. And he becomes that first fruit, promising us that yes, we will one day die, unless he returns first. We will die, we will pass from this life, but we can have a hope that is anchored in a solid life, in an indestructible life. And I want you to see how several times the writer of Hebrews talks about that indestructible life, that life with that will never end. And in a way, similar to Melchizedek, not exactly like Melchizedek, but similar to Melchizedek. We don't know where he came from, and we don't have any record of his death. What we have here in Jesus Christ is that we do know where he came from. He came from the Father, and we do know that he lives today, because he has that indestructible life. So Christ is the one and only, based on the fact that his life lives forever. And the second thing we see here, if you look at verse 19, you see that he is the better hope. He is the better way. Here's what the writer says here in verses 18 and 19. He says, the former regulation is set aside because it was weak and useless. For the law made nothing perfect. And a better hope is introduced, by which we draw near to God. Christ is the better hope. The law, what they used to practice, was weak. It had no real strength. That word useless there, that's translated in the NIV, it could also be translated disadvantageous. Okay? Not advantageous to you. Now think about this a little bit, what the Jewish people had to go through on a regular basis. Alright? They would sin, they would have to keep up with what sins they had committed, and then therefore they'd have to kind of figure it all out. They'd have to figure out what offerings they'd have to bring, what sacrifices were required for that, what offerings, how much grain, how much salt, what kind of animal they would bring, how many of those animals that they would have to bring at just the right time. And so they would do all that, they'd gather together, they'd go down to the temple, they would give it to the priest would sacrifice for that, and guess what? Just like you and just like I, by the time they turned around from offering that sacrifice, they had already sinned again, so they had to start tabulating already all over again about, here's another sin, okay, well, I got to figure it out here, okay, another week I got to bring this back to pay for this sin, and over and over and over and over again. How do you think that would get you to feel? How worn out and tired you would get just trying to keep up with those things. And that's why the writer here says, again, not that it was wrong, because God established that, and God established that system there to show them how futile it was to think that somehow I can do what needs to be done for the forgiveness of my sins. I can't. I never will. Kind of my translation of this, Dan Revised Standard Version of these verses here. It goes like this. What the writer of Hebrews is saying. He says, I know this way of life. Priests continually offering sacrifices over and over and over again, never really being completely free from your sin and your guilt, is all that you've ever known. That's all you've ever known. That's what you grew up with. It's just doing these sacrifices over and over and over again, trying to somehow get yourself right with God. But there's a better way. There's lasting hope. And here is the real deal, okay? Here's what you've been looking for all your life. Here is the one and only that you can put your hope and your trust in. And if you'll put your hope and your trust in Him, you don't have to keep offering these sacrifices over and over again, trying to be right and trying to be good. All you have to do is put yourself into His hands, and He'll take care of that for you. Amen?
Amen.
That's where we put our hope. That's where we put our trust. It's hard to let go, though. It was hard for them to let go 2,000 years ago, these Jews, of letting go of what they had grown up with. That's what their grandparents had known, and their parents had known. That's all that they'd ever known. That's what they had been teaching their children to do. It's hard to let go sometimes of what we're used to. But when you give yourself over, put your hope and trust in Jesus Christ, you find that He's a better hope. Find that you don't have to continually try to be good on your own. You can trust in His righteousness. And then when you do that, and here's the joy of what it means to be a believer in Jesus Christ, is when you really trust in Him as your Lord and Savior, no longer are you trying to measure up to Him, because you realize, I can never measure up to Him. I can never do all that I need to do. But through Him, I've been made right, and so now I get to live my life trying to please Him. Not trying to earn His favor, but just saying thank You for who You are and what You've done. There's a better hope. There's a better way. And we find that better hope and we find that better way in Jesus Christ, and that's what the author of Hebrews is trying to help us to understand. He's saying, let go of trying to do it on your own. Let go of trying to be good enough. Trying to pay enough and work enough and restore enough and doing all those kinds of things to try to do it on your own. Let go of that. Put your trust in Jesus Christ. That's where your anchor will hold. Why? Because what Christ offers us is a new covenant. And I want you to see that from verse 22. He talks about that covenant there of what we need to understand. He says, here is a new covenant. All right. The old covenant was about counting your sins, bringing your sacrifice, sacrificing your offering, and doing it all over again. Okay? Count your sin. Bring your sacrifice. Sacrifice. Do it all over again. Count your sin. Bring your sacrifice. Sacrifice it. Do it all over again. That was the old covenant. What's the new covenant? What's the covenant that God requires from us? To Him, acknowledge your sin. Admit that you have fallen short. Admit that you're not perfect. Admit that you're not normal and you never will be normal. Again, favorite title of all time of a book. Maybe another one will come along sometime or not. But John Ortberg's book, Everybody's Normal Until You Get to Meet Him, Until You Get to Know Him. You know, everybody looks normal on the outside, but then as soon as you spend a few days with them, it's been about a minute and a half of a minute. It's not normal. I can do that with you too. You know, everybody looks normal on the outside until you get to know them. Then when you get to know them, oh, you know what? They have their issues. They're not perfect. They have things they deal with. They sin just like me. Maybe not the exact sins I sin. Their sin may be different than mine, but we all fall short. And we have to acknowledge that. Not going to be perfect. We acknowledge our sin. Then the new covenant says, instead of then trying to make up for that, instead of trying to somehow on your own make it right, you ask for forgiveness. Based on Christ's sacrifice.
not your sacrifice, but on Christ's sacrifice. You acknowledge that you're a sinful person. You acknowledge that you've fallen short, and you mess up, that you do things wrong. We all, if we're honest with ourselves, admit that we're not perfect and we sin. And then you ask for that forgiveness from Jesus Christ, realizing that you can't be good enough, that you can trust in Him. And the New Covenant says this, and you get to live your life with Christ. You get to thank Him the rest of your life, saying, thank you, Jesus, for what you've done. And that's what I try to describe, and especially when I'm talking to children a lot of times about how to live your life, because we taught our children early on in life that, you know, when you get a present from somebody, obviously you don't pay for that, okay? Grandma and grandpa give you a present, or mom and dad give you a present, or somebody gives you a present. You know, it's not a present if you have to pay for it. But one thing you do is you write up a thank you note. Okay, you make sure that you acknowledge thank you for what you've done for me. I'm not paying you for this. I never could pay you for that, and that's not the intent. But I can say thank you. That's why I usually describe our life to Jesus Christ. When we really understand what He's done for us, when we understand the great gift that He's given to us, that's how we live our lives from that point forward. It's just, God, I can't repay you for what you've done, but thank you. And so therefore, I want to do the things that you call me to do. Therefore, I want to know what your word says about how I should live my life and what I should do and when I should do it and what is going to be pleasing to you. I just want to say thank you, Jesus, for what you did for me. That's what happens when somebody really gets what it means to trust in Christ as their Lord and Savior. That's the New Covenant. It's that we just get to spend the rest of our life saying, thank you, Jesus. I'm a sinner. You made the sacrifice. And when I trust in you, I can truly believe in you as my Lord and Savior. So the last thing I want you to see from these verses here is that Christ is the one who ultimately meets our needs. He gives a list there, especially in verses 24 through 28. He gives a list of the things that who Jesus Christ is. And I'm not going to go through that whole list here. But what he's basically saying here is that no mere man or woman can meet our needs in the way that Jesus Christ can. And I couldn't help but think eHarmony. Okay, I've never had to use eHarmony. eHarmony didn't exist. 25 years ago, actually 26 years ago, Susan and I got married. But you know, eHarmony's out there right now, and I guess they do a pretty good job. I mean, if you listen to their commercials, you know, what is it, 90-some% of people that get together stay together. So I guess they're doing something pretty good there. And you know, they claim to make the best matches. They claim to be the ones that can, you know, scientifically decide, you know, who's compatible and who's not, and they can bring them together and all those kinds of things. That's a great thing, okay? But even they're not going to get it right all the time. But God does. God's the one that meets all of our needs. And He can pull us together and get us in a right relationship with Him because of who He is. Ultimately, we are called to be holy. But we can never be holy. We're called to be holy and to be perfect, just as Jesus Christ is. We can never do that. Only Christ is holy. Only He is the one that lived that perfect life for us. The life that we could never live, the life that we never will live, He lived that life for us. He lived and showed us what it is to live a perfect, righteous life. We all fall short and are guilty in our sins, and yet Christ lived in this world for 33 years, and Christ was innocent in those 33 years. Never once did He falter in sin. Not even one time could you say, well, no, that isn't what you should do, Jesus. You have to ask for forgiveness for that. Never once did He do that, and yet we have to do that continually. And so we see that He is the one that can meet our needs because He is the one that's completely innocent in all ways. We are stained by the sin of the world. Even if it's not our fault, we're impacted by the sin of the world. We get caught up in that sin. We're stained by that sin. It's always a dangerous thing to wear a white shirt. We went out to eat the other day, and I had this new white shirt on. I went to a Mexican restaurant. It happens all the time, you know. And it's always the, you know, the kind of sauce drops on you, and you have bread all over you. You get stained, okay? Well, we get stained by this world, the sin of this world, on a regular basis. regular basis. And yet what this passage tells us is that Christ lived on this earth. And never once did that stain get on him. Because he was perfect, he was holy, and he was righteous. We're sinners living amongst a bunch of other sinners. And here in this room today, we're a bunch of sinners living amongst each other. And when we go out from here, we're going to be amongst a bunch of other sinners because we're all sinful. And this passage of Scripture tells us that Christ was sinless among sinners. We're of the earth. Okay, we're flesh and blood. Christ was flesh and blood too. But we're of the earth, and this is where we are. He will one day exalt us, but Christ was exalted before he ever came to this earth. Even when he took on flesh, we're told in Scripture, he didn't consider equality with God something to be grasped, but he never lost his divinity. He did set it aside for a time on his own, in the right way, in the right time. He did that, but he was 100% God, and he was 100% man, and so he was always divine. We're of the earth. Christ is exalted above the heavens. He's the one that meets our needs. So when we read this passage of Scripture here, this is the gospel. This is what it means to put our hope and our trust in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Why do we need to trust in him? We don't trust in ourselves. We don't trust in others. We don't trust in those that we hope can maybe do something for us. But we put our trust in the one true living God. You know, our world is full of knockoffs and substitutes for the real thing. How do you know if you're getting what's real and good? I've noticed one of the, I guess at least for me, I get on Facebook and kind of just troll around for a little bit, and then I click off and I send my verse of the day, and then after that I just kind of look for a little bit and move off. But one thing I've noticed fairly recently, this maybe have been going on for a while, that on Facebook, when somebody needs something, they'll send it out to all their Facebook friends and say, do you know of a good fill in the blank, you know, a good plumber, or a good place to go, or a good restaurant, or whatever, you know, that they're looking for somebody that they can trust. Of course, you know you can trust all your Facebook friends, right? But they're saying, hey, I want to make sure I'm getting the real deal here. I want to make sure that I'm getting something that's going to last, something that's going to be credible, especially when you're looking at work on your house or something like that. You know, I want a good contractor. I want somebody that's done a good job and will do me a good job. And that's normal. That's what we ought to do. Well before Facebook ever came onto the scene here, the writer of Hebrews is saying to the people of his day, and he's saying to us today, here's somebody you can trust. Here's somebody who is the real deal. Here's the one who has an indestructible life. Right? He lived, he breathed, he died, and he rose again. The resurrection is real and true, and because of that, you can put your hope and trust in him. He's not going to be one of those sand islands that's here one day and gone tomorrow, but he's going to last. You can put your life into him. You can anchor yourself into him as Lord and Savior. Know that he's going to be there, not just for a week, not just for a year, not for a decade, not even just for your lifetime, but for eternity. He's going to be there for you. You can trust in him because he is the one and only. So my question to you today is, where are you putting your trust in your life? Can you truly say today that your anchor is in Jesus Christ? Not just partly in Jesus Christ, not just occasionally in Jesus Christ. But if you truly anchored your life to Jesus Christ today, don't settle for false substitutes that this world has to offer. Trust in him and trust in him alone. So we'll come here to our time of invitation here in just a moment. I'm going to ask whether or not you can truly say today that my hope, my trust, my confidence is truly in Jesus Christ and no other. We live in this world, we act in this world, and we interact in this world. But you put your trust in Jesus Christ as your solid foundation in everything and in everywhere. If not, I challenge you today to make him your one and only for your life. If If you would please stand and I'll pray. Father, I come before you right now and I thank you for these words that you inspired to be written, you have preserved for us to read. Father, I pray that we will put our hope and trust in you and you alone this day. You are the one and only. You are our only source of hope and life. So I pray today that we'll trust in you as our Lord and Savior. And I believe this day, but every day of our lives, living our lives, thanking you for who you are and how we can live.